industry is doing and what are your concerns, what are your challenges and what you're looking for from the government. My primary objective is to get to know you and also to listen to you. At the same time, I will also share with what is our current thinking and whatever our new initiatives, so that you might deliberate on those and we'll try to see that what type of partnership we can enter into for the common goals and common objectives. The president spoke very well this morning. He gave a lot of statistics. Very interesting. I'll say that we are now, we in the government, we see that we are flooded with aspirations. Aspirations of large number of youth of aware. And I believe that the ecosystem, the statutory framework you are talking about, even the constitutional framework you are talking about, to meet those aspirations. We have been seeing the last 3-4 months, the result of the Lok Sabha elections, the thinking of the government, and nobody would have believed that they will bring in constitutional amendment bill, and so many bills, so many acts, so many policies. They are all being driven by, I'll again say, the aspirations of young India. So, but whatever is the regulatory framework, the labor laws, labor reform, all that, it will be the collective decision. So there are various stakeholders who have their viewpoints. In the unions, there are, we sometimes criticize them, we always talk to them, we work with them. There are also important stakeholders. The staffing industry is a stakeholder. In a democracy of the size of India, there are numerous stakeholders. And whatever regulatory and constitutional framework you will have, it will be the collective decision of India. It might take some time, but I have the conviction that nobody in India will be able to resist the need of the aspirations again that we are now facing. And whosoever, maybe staffing federation, or staffing industry, government, or the training industry, whosoever is able to meet the aspirations, to manage the aspirations, will win the day. So let us keep, that is my key thought to share with you in details, that let us keep that broad perspective in view whenever we talk, we discuss anything. Our objective is to see that how to manage those aspirations, guide those aspirations, so that every young Indian who is going to join the college gets an opportunity according to his potential, according to his aptitude. That is the final touchstone which will all of us will have to work for. So maybe it is a formal job, informal job, a skilled job, unskilled job, career progression. Everything will have to see that they can't be driven, the young Indians. They are aspirational, highly aspirational. And that you are seeing in every field, in politics, in electoral politics, in the debate in media, in debate in television. Everybody is grappling that how to meet those aspirations everywhere. We are also doing a bit, at our level, our thinking is, in a government collectively, that to reap the very demographic dividend and how to connect the youth with ultimately job opportunities. Every single individual has that desire of having a work opportunity, job opportunity to his liking, to his aptitude and to his potential. How one of the major component of our thinking is the guidance, which you must have been reading the newspapers and all this whole business of National Career Service and Career Centers. Because I was reading one very good article in the newspaper. The children of people who are sitting in the hall, including me, all they have access to all the relevant information about career opportunities. But the son or daughter of a poor farmer, he or she doesn't have that opportunity. Information about the career. So they go on the hearsay, so what are their neighbor or family or teacher to tell them. So our intent is to have that opportunity, have that access to information to the people who are, to the young people who are coming from rural India, semi-urban India, urban India. They should have access to the latest, most relevant information about career options. Options about training, about skilling, all they can do. We are trying to provide them opportunities in areas of skill, apprenticeship. The area that is coming up for discussion is the last mile employability, finishing school, and then skill upgradation for the existing workforce. Some of the recent initiatives are to make the vocational training demand responsive. You must have read in the newspapers about Flexi MOU. It's a very new thing. The Flexi MOU with national level certification, it's a very, very new novel thing. There were some experiments, some work done in the states which we have adopted. And it's the whole effort is to make the vocational training curricula customized according to the industry need. And the policies which we have come out, they are not restricted to just the employers. Now they allow even the staffing companies, they allow even the training institutions. Of course, there are certain guidelines and requirements. Only test is that 80% people should find work after their training. So we have entered into a number of Flexi MOUs. This will be a big challenge for us to organize their specialized course modules, to approve them, to take and all. But this is one very important beginning, because not general criticism was that the curriculum is not only outdated, it is also straitjacketed. Everybody can't find that. Curriculum has to be dynamic and has to be customized. And I was reading somewhere in China, they say that curriculum is national driven, the national driven. One is the local, state level, provincial level, and one is the local driven. So there's a flexibility required, that's what we have brought in. In general, curricula has also been revamped. The vocational training, which I handle as DG, the curricula has been revamped with active involvement of industry councils. And I'm very happy to share with you, you must be also knowing, this revamped curricula has come into force from August 14th session. So a lot of obsolete things have been taken out, a lot of new things have been added. And it was a big challenge to do it in the last 4 or 5 months. So we have done it. Another important area is apprentices. You spoke about only 2.5 lakh apprentices. This is extremely important. But there are two major barriers to expanding the apprentices. One is the, of course, legal framework. The legal framework needs to be more flexible at the same time, the safeguards, so that there is always few people saying that, okay, you are promoting the misuse of cheap labor in the garb of apprentices. So safeguard that apprentices is main objective is to train, not for work. Work is a byproduct. So that is met. So legal framework is being tweaked. Very important changes included in the bill which have been passed by the Lok Sabha, and we are very hopeful in the next session Rajya Sabha will take it. But the other major barrier is the ability of the small to be the cost of stipend. Because there's a lot of feedback that if you the legal framework, things will not work to the scale which we are looking at. There's a need for industry MSMEs for apprentices. So we are working on a scheme broadly with the objective that in the first 2 years of training, the 50% stipend is shared by the government. So that this is a very important opportunity for the people to get skilled. So that scheme we are working on, and we are very hopeful that in the next 1 or 2 months that scheme should be rolled out. It's a very major employability. I spoke very briefly. We are thinking that whoever is the youth coming to employment exchanges and career centers will be given an opportunity to join in last mile employability module, maybe of 10 days or 12 days, so that he has those soft skills, social skills, computer literacy and all, so that he is more employable. So that is also under progress, and we hope that by December or so it will be available in a pilot mode to some career centers. Let me talk about the career centers now. You must have read much in the newspaper about transformation of employment exchange into career centers. They already have that mandate to some extent in employment exchanges, career counseling, but it has been neglected over the years. They don't have the career option content, they don't have the skills about career counseling, and it has somewhere left out from their job profile. So it is now being again revamped in a big way, so that the main approach in the employment exchange is not just job matching. Job matching will be there, but main emphasis will be on counseling and guidance. Somebody comes in, the career center should have sufficient updated information about the career options available in India, in the state, in the district, the local industry, what are the options available. And they will be having some say basic tools and say tests to see that what is the aptitude and potential. They should be able to guide the young person about, again, the training opportunities, the apprenticeship opportunities, what are the opportunity for employability module, for skill upgradation. So they should be able to guide the youth. And once they are available, then according to their capability and their aptitude, the career center will also do the job matching. So for job matching, you must be knowing that we are now building up a national portal called National Career Service Portal, which will be definitely building up the efforts which states have done. Many states have tried their employment exchanges, they also have their portals. So one of the key purpose of my coming here is that I want to listen to you, that what you are looking for from this National Career Service Portal and the career centers. And I'll leave one thought with you, that career centers which we have written states, that concept is available. It leaves a lot of space to the states to work with private sector, with industry associations like you. So I will encourage that if Staffing Federation can look and say, they say you come forward, say, okay, you will take up two or three career centers in India and make them. What are we doing? The staffing is also is working for careers. So I will leave that idea with you. Think over it. There are 50 model career centers which are scheduled to come up in India in this financial year. Some of them will be located in, say, our vocational rehabilitation centers. Around 37-38 will be located in the states. States will have two, the smaller states will have one. And we have in that concept, we have left to the states that what model they will like to adopt. We will give certain basic support in terms of finances, the capacity building, the tools, and the career content. But the way it's run, the career center is left open to the states. We have given some broad guidelines. It can be NGO driven, it can be a corporate driven, it can be an industry association driven, it can be PPP. So for you to look at some where you find it, you can work with the state government, we will work with you, we will support you. Now, just to wind up this, just to close my talk, there are two different views which we have been reading. Traditional view is that the human resource should have the loyalty, commitment, and job security to deliver the best. That is the traditional, conventional taught in the management schools. That human resource who is there for you 6 months will not have the loyalty and commitment to the organization. He will not be ingrained in the work culture of the organization. The second other is that the young person, they want mobility, progression,